Hi, I'm Dr. Mary Dan Eades, and today I'm going to present a look at nutrition as a modulator of health and athletic performance. Here are my disclosures, such as they are. I research and write about health and nutrition, and I get paid to do that, and I co-own a small nutritional supplement company. For optimal outcome, it is a must, a need to have, not a nice to have. After having spent decades in the nutritional trenches, I can assure you that there is no drug or procedure more potent in improving long-term health than in changing the way you eat. Trying to optimize health, or athletic performance for that matter, without proper nutritional foundation is, as Coach Glassman often put it, like rowing with one oar out of the water. Feed your body what it needs to prosper, avoid what hurts it, and get out of the way. Knowledge is power in nutrition, the power to move the metabolic needle in whichever way you choose. In the end, nutrition is nothing more than applied biochemistry. Every bite you eat, every sip you drink has a metabolic consequence, for good or for ill. And so it behooves us all to understand what those consequences are. If our goal is to build a lean body, preserve lean tissues, to strengthen ourselves, to make our metabolism run as smoothly and as efficiently as possible for as long as possible, how do we do that? With applied biochemistry. So let's begin with a 50,000 foot view of nutritional biochemistry, looking at what each nutrient does and the role that it plays in controlling metabolism. I promise it will be brief, and I will only mention the Krebs cycle once. The food we eat comes in as three macronutrients: protein, carbohydrate, and fat. Through the process of digestion and absorption, these macros provide us with the raw materials for life. Our GI tract disassembles the proteins into their amino acid building blocks. It breaks the disaccharides into their simple sugars. It turns starch into glucose, and it emulsifies and disassembles the fats. And from there, it all enters the circulation and is sent to the tissues to be burned for energy, to be used for growth or repair, or to be stored for later. Far and away, the most important of the macros is protein. It's the cornerstone of the human diet. It's the center of the plate. It's the nutrient that early humans with sharpened sticks hunted large animals to extinction to obtain. Apart from water, it's the most essential nutrient for life. Protein malnutrition of sufficient length, as you know, is lethal. We cannot manufacture protein. It must come from the diet. We reassemble amino acids from the protein we eat to make all of the more than 10,000 different protein compounds within the body. And while we can fashion some of the amino acids out of other ones, we can't manufacture the 9 essential ones. These we must consume. But ideally, the food that we eat provides all of the complete array of 20 amino acids. The protein could come from animal sources, which are complete and more bioavailable to us. Wherever it comes from, though, we need to eat a sufficient amount of it to grow when we're young and throughout our lives to repair and replace lean tissue, such as our muscles, our bones, sinew, organs, blood, epithelium, endothelium, gut lining, hair, all of it, as well as to produce all of the enzymes, hormones, and neurotransmitters that we depend on to live. And in round numbers, here's what food provides us. We get about 7 grams of protein in an ounce of meat, fish, or poultry, about 6 to 10 in an ounce of beans. It depends on the bean, soybeans at the top of the list. A whole egg provides 6 grams of protein, 4 in the white. And from dairy, we get about 7 grams of protein in an ounce of hard cheese, about half that much in an ounce of yogurt, and about a gram or so in a fluid ounce of milk. Each gram of protein provides us with 4 calories. Fat, however, is our main calorie source of energy, and it really ought to be. Burning 9 calories per gram, it's the highest octane fuel that we have available. On a lower carbohydrate diet, fats will make up the largest percentage of our daily calories. But quality here is more important than quantity. We can find healthful natural fats in both the plant and animal kingdoms. It's in the fat of the meat, the fish, poultry, eggs, and dairy that we eat. It's in nuts and seeds and oily fruits, such as avocados, coconuts, and olives. But the type of fat we eat is what's more important. and not in the way we once thought. New research indicates that we might not want to be loading up so much on PUFAs, polyunsaturated fats, because evidence is beginning to emerge of deleterious effects that might help to explain the obesity explosion of the last three decades. The saturation or unsaturation of dietary fat impacts the end products of fat burning in the mitochondria in ways that we can influence the overall metabolic milieu of our body and determine whether we store calories or we burn them. These fats may indeed be making us fat, but that's not true of all fats. Contrary to a couple of decades of received medical wisdom, saturated fat is no longer believed to be the cholesterol and cardiovascular villain it once was, not even by the American College of Cardiology, as this 2020 review points out. Natural fats are something we should eat, and we should not be afraid of natural saturated fat. Carbohydrates are burned for energy or stored as glycogen. Any excess gets turned into fat. We find carbs to varying degrees in all foods of plant origin, fruits, nuts, seeds, vegetables, legumes, roots, tubers, and in concentrated form in sugar beets, sugar cane, maple sap, cereal grains, and the milled and refined products that come from all of those. But whether it's from broccoli or a bagel, all carbohydrates are simple sugars, disaccharides, or polysaccharides, starches, which themselves are just long chains of glucose molecules that are easily broken down by digestion. In the end, it's all absorbed as sugar. So why do we need them? Actually, we don't. There are no carbohydrate deficiency diseases. That's not to say that we humans aren't quite capable of using carbohydrate, of course, but they are completely non-essential to our health and survival because the human liver can make plenty of glucose from amino acids. It can churn out up to 200 grams or so a day as you need it to support the few tissues of the body that require it. Red blood cells, a few cells in the kidney, some in the brain. But humans evolved to thrive chiefly on protein and fat. Carbs evolutionarily served as a backup, as a calorie substitute for fat when bigger, fattier game animals were not available or were less plentiful. But there's ultimately a limit, a ceiling for how much naked lean protein humans can consume, and fats or carbs fill up the rest. But food isn't just raw material building blocks. It's more than just calories. The macros incite a metabolic response as well, and it's that response where the nutritional rubber meets the biochemical road. What we eat drives the hormones of metabolism, chiefly insulin and its counter-regulatory hormone, glucagon. And in this regard, all calories are definitely not created equal. A calorie is more than just a calorie. There's a vast difference in what happens metabolically between eating 4 ounces of steak and 4 ounces of sushi rice. Again, from the 50,000 foot level, here's what happens to the food we take in. When we digest and absorb protein, it causes both a small rise in insulin and a small rise in glucagon. On a lower carbohydrate diet, that little burst of insulin drives amino acids into the muscles. And that little balancing burst of glucagon keeps blood sugar stable in the face of that little burst of insulin that would otherwise cause it to fall. Fat, for all of its bad rap, is pretty much a source of metabolically neutral calories. It doesn't especially move insulin or glucagon in either direction. For the most part, it's either burned for energy or stored for use later, depending on need and on the current metabolic hormonal milieu. Carbs, however, are a different story. Carbs incite a Mad Hatter's Tea Party of metabolic effect. And when you combine carbs and fat, it's a veritable insulin rave. Digested carbs, whether they're starch or sugar, raise blood glucose. After all, they are glucose. In the human body, glucose is kept very tightly controlled. It's actually quite toxic to the endothelium at high levels. So the body tries to get it out of the bloodstream and into the tissues. There's not much of it in the bloodstream normally. It may surprise you to learn how much dissolved glucose constitutes, a normal blood sugar of 80 milligrams per deciliter. a teaspoon. In the 5 or so liters of blood in an adult human, there's just about a teaspoon of glucose. Compare that to the 7 teaspoons that we would find in a can of sugar-sweetened soda, or in a bagel, or a bowl of Fruit Loops. The body is designed such that a rising glucose raises insulin, and then high insulin puts everything into storage mode, shoving glucose out of the blood, shutting down lipolysis, shutting down ketosis, and promoting the storage of calories from all macronutrient sources, and really driving a whole lot of other things like cholesterol synthesis and sodium retention, just to name a couple. The connection is straightforward. Eating carbs raises insulin. Excess insulin causes problems. When insulin's elevated chronically, even though the body has plenty of stored fat to access for energy, the pathways to get it out are closed. The only solution left to fill an energy deficit then is to eat more. The right nutritional structure can make all the difference in stamina, in energy, strength, fitness, not to mention in health. And nutritional science backs up the lower carbohydrate approach as the most effective, certainly for restoring a healthy metabolism. This landmark 1996 study by Raven and Golay was the first to show the superiority of a low-carb diet on metabolic health parameters. Weight loss was about the only thing that was similar, and there have been many studies since then that show the same thing. Take these 67 trials that compare a low-fat and a low-carb diet for weight loss. Before you think it's just about weight, there are also many more looking at diabetes. You can access them online from the link at the bottom of these slides. So go see for yourself. CrossFit, from practically its founding, recognized the interdependence of nutrition and physical exercise for best results. For years, that meant recommending that its athletes adopt a prescribed dietary structure based on the zone diet as a starting point. That was designed to get the right building blocks in place to achieve a desired outcome and then tweaking it. So what is the zone? Or more correctly, what is zone nutrition? The zone diet described by Dr. Barry Sears in 1995 contains 30% of its calories as protein, 40% of its calories as carbohydrate, and 30% as fat. This precise combination of basic nutrients, according to Dr. Sears, put a person into the zone, where the body would run its best. To make it easier to follow the zone, it broke these basic nutrients into a system of blocks of macronutrients, so that a person would eat an equal number of blocks at each meal or snack throughout the day. The recommended amount of protein for each person was set precisely according to their lean body mass, and then fixed as 30% of calories. But rigid adherence to that 30-40-30 structure can cause some issues, especially for the out-of-shape newcomer to fitness. Let's look at a couple of examples of blocks in action. An average-sized woman, a medium-sized woman, according to a typical zone chart, would need 11 blocks of protein, carbohydrate, and fat a day, divided up as 3 blocks for breakfast, 3 for lunch, 3 for dinner, and a block at each of 2 snacks. Her macronutrient intake becomes 77 grams of protein, 99 grams of carb, and 16.5 grams of fat. When you add all that up, you get 852 calories total. If the woman was 140 pounds, she's 548 calories under the recommended 10 calories a pound for an average person. And she's going to be starving to death. What if she's a larger unfit woman? Let's say she weighs 175 pounds. She would get 13 blocks a day with macros that are 91 grams of protein, 117 grams of carb, and 19.5 grams of fat. Her total calories will be 1,007 a day. She's in a calorie deficit of 743 calories based on the recommended caloric intake for her weight. Now, I hasten to add, she probably does not want to maintain her weight if she weighs 175 pounds. Well, she might. But either way, she's going to be very hungry. And here is the problem. She's being asked to eat 117 grams of carb a day. But to make up the calorie deficit she's in, she's got to be able to access her fat stores. And for someone who's insulin resistant, whose insulin is likely up already, she probably can't do that on that many carbs. So we'll up her to 1,500 calories a day. But on that 30-40-30 structure, That means she's going to be expected to eat even more carbs. She's going to be eating 600 calories of carb a day, or 150 grams, and she will never get her insulin down on 150 grams of carb a day, and she'll stay hungry. Hunger is like gravity. You can hang on for a while, but ultimately it will win. So the zone can become something of a trap really for everybody, but especially for the metabolically unfit athlete, unless it is strongly tweaked out of its zoneness. The difference between this fat, young, metabolically flexible person and a middle-aged or out of shape, overweight is the metabolic milieu. The athlete on the left of this slide can probably withstand upping her macros to fit that zone perfect structure. Although what she's more likely to do is the well-known CrossFit hunger fix, just add fat blocks. And that's the correct fix, but it's no longer zone perfect. As a percentage of calories, fat will go up. It's no longer 30, 40, 30, and I believe that's just fine. The overweight, out of shape athlete on the right has got to get her carbs lower to drop her insulin and be able to access all that stored body fat. She's got to drop her carb blocks, and she needs to raise her fat blocks. She may need a lot of them. An easier solution is to abandon the strict adherence of trying to be zone perfect, to think in terms of absolute amounts of macros, not percentages. What does the body require? What moves the metabolism, and how do you want to move it? So let's look at how much food a person needs. In the young, physically and metabolically fit, or at least not metabolically broken athlete, the recommendation could be as simple and straightforward as this prescription well known to CrossFitters. Eat meat, vegetables, nuts and seeds, some fruit, little starch, and no sugar. You should eat if you're hungry, you should drink if you're thirsty, and you should eat along those parameter guidelines. That's it. For a lot of people, that's all they need. For those who want or need numbers, you set the protein minimum to be sufficient to support the lean body mass at whatever level it's working. And that's just like in the zone, but it's a minimum, not a fixed set point. So it's not a trap. Ballpark numbers we have used, about a half to 1 gram of complete protein per pound of lean body mass, depending on age and depending on level of physical activity. Older people need more. Research has pegged the optimal daily intake between about 0.7 grams a pound a day and 1 gram a pound a day. Those numbers in that equation refer to pounds of body weight, not to lean body mass. So our recommendation is going to be on the higher end of that scale. But up to about 25 to 30% of calories as protein, maybe even a little more, is well tolerated by most people. Those with known renal disease do not fall into the most people category. If muscle or lean body mass building is a desired outcome, that upper limit is better. If it's a person over 65, that upper limit is necessary because aging depresses protein synthesis efficiency. Protein intake in excess of needs could be turned into fat, but the process is very inefficient. Amino acids in excess of what is needed for protein synthesis are oxidized ultimately through, okay, get ready for it, the Krebs or citric acid cycle. That's the one mentioned. So step one in tailoring nutrition is to determine the lean body mass. You can do it with underwater weighing, with bioimpedance, with fat calipers, with a tape measure and a pencil and a little math. But whatever it is, you're going to feed that number of pounds, that number of lean body mass pounds, a half to 1 gram of complete protein per day as a minimum. Then you set the carbohydrate intake as an absolute number of grams, not as a percentage. Regardless of size or shape, everybody's blood sugar is going to rise with incoming carb. Everybody's insulin is going to rise with rising glucose. Now, in the young and the healthy, it's going to recover more quickly. But in the middle-aged, the older, the metabolically broken, obese, diabetic, hypertensive person who's essentially carbohydrate intolerant, the response to carb is going to be more robust. Their blood sugar is going to rise higher. It's going to stay up longer in response to too much carb, especially if it's refined or processed carb. That's going to be a problem. Fit or sort of fit folks will tolerate something in the range of 50 to 100 or maybe 150 grams of effective carbohydrate a day. They don't have to have this much. but they'll tolerate it and do pretty well with as much as, let's say, 20 to 25 grams of effective carb a meal. The metabolically unfit or overweight person has to go lower. They should begin at 20 to 30 grams of effective carbohydrate per day. That's just 7 to 10 grams of carb a meal. What does effective carbohydrate mean? That concept, we call the ECC, is one my husband and I developed in the late 1980s to describe the portion of carbohydrate intake that has an effect on the metabolic system, mainly on the glucose and insulin axis. The ECC is the total amount of carbohydrate content, all the starch, the sugar, the fiber, everything that counts as a carbohydrate minus the fiber, because it's not absorbed and it has no measurable effect on blood sugar or insulin. So what would 7 to 10 grams of effective carbohydrate content look like in food? It's a surprising amount of nutritious food. It could be 2 cups of broccoli or bell pepper or cherry tomatoes. It could be 8 cups of lettuce. It could be 3 cups of zucchini or a cup of eggplant or strawberries. Or it could be a third of a bagel or a teaspoon and a half of sugar. And those don't give you much carbohydrate bang for your buck. It's best to avoid processed refined carbs if possible. Pulverizing carbohydrates increases their effect through stimulation of incretin release in the gut. Incretins in the foregut are insulin amplifiers. The more something's processed, the bigger the insulin response will be. The point is to make the carbs count, make them densely nutritious, go for volume, go for color. And that brings us to the burning question, how much fat? Fat intake, as I said, is more about quality than quantity. Good fats will make up the balance of a person's caloric needs on a low-carb structure, and they should come from natural fats in the proteins they eat, from butter, from cheese, yogurt, from fatty fruits, avocados, coconuts, olives. But you should scrupulously avoid processed PUFAs, the so-called vegetable oils that are in industrially processed damaged seed oils. So once you have all this set up and you're going along, how do you know if you're going to need to modify something? You do it based on your results. How do you know that? You keep a diet journal. You write it all down, all the intake, what you eat, what you drink, good or bad. If you fell off the wagon, think about why you did it and write that down too. Record your weight, your measurements, but only like weekly or biweekly. Record those things just like you'd record your progress on your WOD. It's one of the best, most useful tools to help tailor your diet. In a daily journal, you'll almost always find the answers to troubleshooting a stalled progress. And here are some of the common ones. If you're hungry, eat more protein and fat. Both are more satiating to your diet than carbs, and they'll have far less metabolic effect. If you're trying to lose weight and you're not losing, eat fewer carbs, maybe fewer calories. Tweak the protein. Is it too low? Is it too high? Because both of those can impact your results, especially in smaller framed people. Look for hidden sources of carb and eliminate pulverized carbs. If you're fatigued, increase salt with bouillon, with olives, with anchovies. Increase potassium sources such as tomatoes, or just add some sea salt and take a supplemental potassium, especially in the early going. These simple, straightforward guidelines put into practice with perseverance and commitment will create a metabolic milieu that will restore health and fitness. One caveat, physician, be prepared. The response to a low carbohydrate diet in those with insulin resistance syndrome will be swift and profound. Medications for blood pressure and blood sugar will need to be adjusted, reduced, and probably eliminated. The combination of low carb nutrition and a potent exercise stimulus, such as CrossFit, is a powerful force for healing. Or, as one icon put it, an elegant solution to the world's most vexing problems. So, thank you for your attention.